Manny here. It's been quite a while since I did a video, so thank you for waiting. but I'm back now to do a demonstration, video, tutorial of this teapot. Exterior surface. This is not a particularly accurate model. It's just a kind of a demonstration of a few techniques. And some techniques are a little bit more advanced, which I'll show you later on, but it will give you the opportunity to make something reasonably sophisticated and smooth, and I'll show you how to do that now. So without further ado, I'm going to dive into a brand new rifle, and we'll start from scratch. Right, so with any modeling tool, the best thing to do is to work from life, or work from some kind of source, rather than just making your mind up about how something looks. You could probably design a teapot on this, you know, by drawing some pictures of it. I think teapot kind of looks like this, maybe. And then it's about coming off, but you'll probably end up with some ugly looking oven and an handle. So, not very nice. So, we're going to start with an image. So, it could be an image that we've drawn. In my case, I'm going to use an image from the internet of a teapot that I quite like. I'm going to place the background bitmap. So what I'm going to do is find my image first, and I've saved it on my desktop. So I'm going to put it into my right view, not my front view. You could put it in my front view, but I'm certainly not going to put it in my top view or my perspective view. So I'm going to put it in my right view here. I'm going to put it in a background bitmap. So it can be a JPEG or a bitmap. So here's the background bitmap that I'm going to use, which is this one. I'm going to place this now so that this image is just drawing it. Now you can see that the grid is kind of interfering with the image, so I'm going to turn the grid off. Grid options, just turn the grid, show grid lines, check that, it will turn it off. Okay, so now my teapot is nice and sitting there. Now, I don't want my teapot to be sitting in this particular location. I actually want it to be sitting nicely on the zero origin. So I'm going to move the background bitmap so that it's in the middle. So I'm going to do background bitmap, move. Point, the command bar is asking me for a point I want to move from, so I'm picking a point in the middle at the bottom. And the point I want to move to is the zero. Enter. I'll just check the top here as well. You see it's slightly, I think possibly the teapot's at a slight angle here, but we'll maybe rotate the bitmap a little bit. So I'm going to go to background bitmap, rotate. Oh no, you can't rotate the background bitmap, of course. We're just going to have to move it. So the point I want to move from is here, and I want to move it just over slightly. So I'm trying to aim for that line to be a little bit closer, and roughly in the middle. Okay, that'll do. So the first thing we're going to do is to create the body of a teapot. And I'm going to use the layers that I already have here as starting points. So the body is going to be the red layer. I'll rename it. Body, and I'll create some sublayers underneath it to organize things. New sublayer, I'll call this curve. Okay, and we're going to do this one. Going to rename this layer, call this spank. And I'll put a new sublayer in here as well, and call this curve. These are construction curves underneath. And this one, we'll call handle, and then new sublayer underneath that, new sublayer, curve. That's curve. And lastly, we're going to go with lid. So those are the basic elements. We've got the curve under here, new sublayer, new sublayer, curve. So I usually have a set of curves underneath my, sometimes I have more than that, profile curves, rail curves, all sorts of different types of curves. But I'm going to put curves just in there, so they all have a set of curves. Now I'm going to start with the body, so I'm going to make the body active. Make sure the tick is in the layer. By the way, if you want to change the order of these layers, you can use these arrows and they'll move those up and down. Okay, so like that. I'll just delete the default layer. tend to do is to tend to make the curves a kind of related color to the usually sort of pastel version of the colors that I'm working with. It is green, so I'm going to make it paler like that. So that's how I organize my layers. Okay, so I'm starting with the body and I'm starting curves. So I'm going to create a profile curve for my body. I'm going to use a curve, control point curve here, and I'm going to start at the zero origin point. And I'm going to start with my shift key down in order to toggle ortho on. You could use ortho, but I'll put that on for now. And I'll do exactly the same thing, and then pressing shift will toggle ortho off. So I'm going to just use my shift key. And what I want to create is three lines in a row. And then I'm coming up. Two lines, two points together in order to create that change in direction, that slightly sharper change in direction. And then what I want to try and do is to create this curve with as few control points as I can. Hidden information here. We don't really know what's quite under there, but I'm sure there'll be something like this. And that will do, I think. And I'm going to turn the control points on for this curve so I can edit that. And I'll just shape this slightly. My near snaps on at the moment, so I'm going to turn it off, which enables me to move the line a little bit more accurately. Sometimes it snaps to the line and push you off your stride a little bit. Okay. Down here, because we're actually not looking at a perfect elevation, I'm just looking at a photograph, there's an ellipse here, which wouldn't be accurate if I followed that line. I'd end up with a teapot with a kind of rounded bottom, which would wobble around on the table like a weebly. And we don't really want that, so what we're going to do is leave it straight here, and we're going to have to kind of fudge that slightly. And that is looking better. So I'm trying to follow the line as closely as I can. You see, when I spin it round, though, you'll see it will. I'm just going to delete this point here, I don't really want that one. So we've got some sort of geometry here that's kind of approximating what it might look like. There, that's. If I want to get a sharper change in direction, I could put a kink in, but that kinks tend to be a little bit too sharp. But if you want to add more detail to the curve and make the curve change direction sharper, you can add control points. Add it to this line and put one there. And that's added another control point there. Curve point, come on. There we go. So there's more ability in that regard to change the direction quicker. When you're working with bitmaps, they tend to be pretty low res, so we don't really want an S happening there. So that'll be fine. And maybe it just needs to go in. Anyway, this isn't going to be seen unless I took the lid off. But that will do fine. What I'm more interested in really is that this the edge curves here match that profile pretty nicely, and they do. So what we're going to do now is to revolve this curve, and that will make the body. So what I'm going to do is to do that, you can do a real revolve, or you can do a round revolve here, just a standard revolve, which is the one we're going to use. The curves I'm going to revolve are this curve here, and it's asking me to confirm that by pressing enter. And the start of the revolution axis is my zero. The end of the revolution axis basically is a point above on the Z axis, straight above on the Z axis. So holding my shift key down, I'm just moving up in the Z axis. I'm clicking, you can see it's spinning around here, but I'm gonna just make sure it spins around fully by pressing full circle. And that will, and that's in the command bar, pressing full circle will guarantee that you get a complete 360 degree revolution. And now that surface, which I'm going to put on the body, I don't want to have that on the curl. I'll change off it there here. That is going to, if I change this to shaded, you can see you have the basic body of my teapot. Okay, so the next bit, I'm going to show you how to make the spout. Okay, the next thing we're going to build now is the spout. So I'm going to have a look at the spout on the drawing, on the photograph. And you can see it's blended nicely into the surface of the spout. So I'm going to try and recreate a nice blended surface. But we need to create the spout first. We need to kind of make the spout, and then we need to bend that into the body of the teapot. So what I'm going to do is to first check that I'm on the spout curves. So I'm going to make that the active layer. And I'm going to use my polyline tool to kind of create some contours that are going to give me some information to work with. So I'm going to go from this point to this point, and this is creating cross sections through my spout. And I'll do another one down here, I think. About there, where it's kind of changing direction. Here it's fairly straight through there, but where it changes direction, that's where I want some information. There's a bit of a direction change here. And then I'll do one more. Right about here. Looks good. Yeah. Okay, so I'll put that in perspective view, and you see that those lines are just lined up like that. So we'll turn the spout, the teapot off. And what I want to try and do, I can't tell from the drawing how wide those are, but what this looks like from the front, because I don't have that information, so I'm going to have to make that up. But I'm going to guess that it's fairly round, like the rest of the teapot, and I'm going to use the ellipse tool here. Now, if I was just to use the standard ellipse tool, I could, if I had my midpoint on, which I do, find a midpoint and go up to there, and that would work. But there's another tool that I find a bit better, which is this one here, which is ellipse diameter to start with. So you can select your long diameter, and then I can create a wide shape there. We'll go for something reasonably round for the base. And then the next one, over here. Yeah, we want this. One to be same deal, maybe just in a little bit more, and then the last one from here to again, here to here. This one just a little bit more elliptical. Think about there would be correct. So it has more of a going to have more kind of long pouring lip at the end. So I've got these profile curves now, and I want to create a surface using these profile curves, and I want to create a sort of stretched surface going through all of these. And the tool for that is the loft tool. So it's in surface, loft, there, or under here, it's this one, loft. Or you can just type in loft, and it will pop up. And lofting requires you to do a few things in order. You can't do this. You can't do a loft from this one to this one to this one to this one, and then say, yeah, that's what I want, because what you'll end up with is a pretty messy kind of surface. What I want is a surface that smoothly transitions between these curves. So I'm going to go from, repeat the command, loft. Let's just right-click to repeat the command. This one, this one, this one, and this one, in that order. I'm going to press enter, and then you can see my seam, the seam lines appearing. These arrows are pointing all in the same direction, and they're all nicely lined up, and that's what we want. If they weren't, if this one was down here, and we did the loft, what would happen was the loft would twist. It would actually try and move backwards and forwards, and that's not the best way to get that form. By the way, if you wanted a form that was zigzagging in and out like this, you would do it in a different way. What you're actually doing is you're twisting the surface, you're forcing the surface to go in lots of different directions, and that tends to make pretty messy meshes. So we don't really want that. And I'll delete that. So I'll do it one last time, a little bit of problem this time. That curve, that curve, that curve, and this curve. Enter. Seam lines in the right direction, they're all lined up, they're all nice and straight. So I'm going to agree to that, and then hit OK. And then I have a nice, smooth surface from which to work with. Okay, so the next thing I'm going to do is to blend this curve, this surface, into this surface here. And to do that, we need to cut a hole in the teapot, and we need to have a look at the curves and the intersectional points to work out how best to make a transition, a smooth transition between these two forms. Okay, so in order to make the spout transition smoothly into the body, we need to cut holes and we need to have a look at the spacing between the sets of holes that we're going to create. Okay, so if I was to try and blend this surface directly into this surface, cutting a hole, several things are not right here. So firstly, the intersection, you can see this intersection is not continuous, there's a gap. Okay, so there's a gap underneath. You can see that edge of the surface poking out and the edge of the surface at the top poking out. So the intersection between these two is really only both sides of this. And we need the intersection to be all the way around. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take this object and I'm going to scale it up. I'm going to use Scale 3D. And I'm going to do the scaling in the right view. And the reason for that is to prevent any shift X and Y. I want the scaling to happen uniformly and it to stay on the X axis. I'm going to scale it up here. And what I've done here is I've also checked that my copy equals yes is on the command bar. So it has to say copy equals yes. If you toggle it, it will say copy equals no. Okay, and now I've made one copy. If I'm to put another point, another place, it will create another copy. But I don't want that, so I'll just escape. So I've got two copies of this object here. So I'm just going to hide this one for a moment, just so I don't have to deal with it. I'm going to take my curve and I'm going to bury it in the surface. Intersection between these two curves, these two surfaces. So what I'm going to do is actually find that intersection, and the way we do that is through the intersection command. So I'm going to select both of these two objects, and just type in intersect, and it will solve that for you. You can also do that in curve, curve from object, there is intersection. So I've got a nice intersection between these two, and I don't now need this. I can delete that now. So I have my intersection curve. I can bring back the first one, and you'll see that that was pretty close, actually. It's pretty close, but you can see here, it's actually smaller, top there, about the same size as the side. But what we need to do is to make this curve further out on this surface, so that there's a little bit more room to make that blend happen. So to do that, I'm going to offset this surface, this curve, on this surface. So to do that, I need to use the offset on surface tool, which is in curve tools, and this one here is offset curve on surface. And click that, and it says select curve on surface. So that's the curve that we generated, the intersection curve. And then it's asking for a base surface. That's my base surface, the teapot. And you get these arrows appearing, which are telling me which direction that offset's going to go. And the distance I want for this is 3, maybe. We'll try 3 to start with. Might need a little bit more. 3 for now, I think we'll just go with, though, because we don't want it to be too big. Okay, that looks good. And the second thing we're going to do is to trim a hole in my teapot. So I'm going to use this curve here to trim a hole in the teapot. So I'm going to trim. That was selected first, so the line is assuming I mean the cutting object to be the first selected object, the curve itself, because it's already asking me for an object to trim. A good tip when you're trimming is to aim for an isocurve, because if you aim at an isocurve and point your cursor at an isocurve on the surface that you're trying to trim away, as soon as you hit that, then you'll get a curve. You get a line. But you see, we've got a problem here, because if we were to try and blend this surface into this surface, we've got a real difficulty with what it does here. It's going to have to go kind of, see, it's deep into the body of the teapot, so it's going to have to come back out again to get a blend back forward. And it'd be a horrible blend. It'd be a messy, messy surface. So what we're going to do is we're going to actually trim this curve here, this surface here, a little bit further. And to do that, we've already got some geometry that we can use. We've got this curve here. We can actually just take that curve and move it forward. So I'm going to take the curve here, select that curve, and I'm going to zoom in to drag it forwards. And when I drag it forward like that, I'm actually going to use it to trim. It's probably a tiny bit too far forward there. I'll just move it back a bit. That will be about right. Yeah, I think that's probably about right. So I'm going to use this curve to trim this face here, but you can see it's not actually intersecting with this spout at all. There's no intersection whatsoever, it's completely separate. But it appears to intersect across here. So if I trim now, I've got the object selected and I want to use as my knife. So if I press trim, you can see there's an option in the command bar that says apparent intersections equals yes. If you toggle that, it'll say no, and it again to say yes. That means that anything that appears to intersect will be trimmed. So now I can select it. Again, I'm going to point out an isocurve, and it will trim that surface. You'll see it disappeared though. And now we can delete that first curve, and we now have a gap. So we have some area that we can use in order to create a blend between one surface and the next surface. So now what we use is in Surface Tools, there's a tool called Blend here, Blend Surface. And what that does is it generates a new surface that's continuous from this surface and continuous from this surface, and you kind of join the two up. And we're going to use that to do this command. So Blend Surface, what it was asking for is the edges. So we need to check this edge, and then I'm also going to check this edge. Okay, and then it creates this handle. If they're, again, like the loft, if they're not in the right position, if they're not in a straight line with each other, then you will probably end up with a twisted, twisted blend. We don't want that. So when we do that, the handle appears, and the next time we press enter, we'll get this option here. I'm using G3 curvature. By default, it will be set to curvature, but I've moved it up to G3. And I want to just tweak those curves just a tiny bit. So you can see as you move the handle around, you can see it will adjust position. So what I'm trying to do is match the position there. So maybe get a little bit more option there, that should do. That one I'm happy with. Okay, and that will blend the surfaces together. So if I analyze this by going analyze surface environment map, you can see when you turn on the environment map, what you're looking for is not any sharp changes in direction. You want a nice smooth change in direction so that there's no obvious kinks or twists or ridges in the blend. And that one looks pretty good for now. Okay, so the next part we're going to work on the handle. So I'll turn off the environment map here, and I can now shift onto the handle. So I'm going to put my my tick in the layer for the handle. I'm going to have a look at the handle. Now the handle's similar; it's blended into the surface here. So we want to create a nice smooth transition through that. But the first thing we'll get to that later a little bit, like the spout. We'll make the handle part first, and then we'll do the blends between the two. Okay, so what we want to first do is to create this shape. To get the information out of that, just like we did for the spout, we need to create a kind of a rail curve, a shape. that this is going to follow, and then I can create more geometry in order to create a three-dimensional surface from that. So what I'm going to use is my control point curve, and I'm going to try and trace the outside edge, just a bit like we traced the outside edge of the form. I'm going to do the same thing, trace the outside edge of our handle. Something like that. I'm not going very near to start with because I can edit it into position. So, move the control points in. Turn my control points on, and I'm now editing the curve in order to try and bring it in as close as I can to the geometry. And that's getting pretty close, a little bit here maybe. Okay. A bit up here. Yep, that's looking good. Okay. You want to turn your control points off, you can just press escape twice, it should turn the control points off. I also need an estimation, just like we did with the teapot spout, an estimation of the thickness of my line. Now I can do that with a near, I can go to near, I can do that near, go from here to here. Okay. And then we'll put that over here, we'll have a kind of estimation. I'll delete this one actually, and I'm going to move this one precisely to the end of that line. And that's given me an idea of the thickness of this. So now, turn the teapot off and the spout off. This little line here is the right height, but it's probably oval. Can't see exactly because it could be round, but I'm guessing it's probably more likely to be oval. So we'll do the same command again, an ellipse from here to here, and I'm going to make this oval. Something like that. Alright, so that's the shape, the profile. So what I want to do is be able to sort of drag this around this shape, kind of sledge it around this curve, and in front to leave the surface behind it as it goes all the way around. And we can do that with a tool called sweep. And we want to sweep along what's called a rail. So this curve here is the rail, and this curve here is the profile curve. That's the profile we want to create as we sweep around the rail. That's the rail. So I'm going to use sweep one rail. To get to it, it's this. Or you could just type in sweep. And it will say sweep one, sweep two. So sweep one. And we want to first select the rail. And then immediately runs off the cross-sectional curve, which is the oval. And we're going to press enter, and again it creates a seam line. We don't have any problem with that because there's only one curve to work with, so it's fine. And then that will create our handle curve. Now, if your curve, I'll just demo this actually, if your curve is very convoluted, for example, and we did the same thing, we swept through it. So we're going to sweep one rail. That's our rail curve. That's our cross-sectional curve. Then you often will get impossible surfaces. So you can see here, for instance, the rail really just can't make that transition. You can't turn and leave a surface behind. So it will create a pretty messy kind of impossible surface. So you might have to experiment a few times and get your curve nice and smooth. My one is actually nice and smooth. My shape has worked out quite well. The surface of the form has worked out nice and smooth with no twists or kinks in the curvature. So I'm quite happy with that. And also, looking at my curvature here on the drawing, it's a little bit wider there. But generally, it's okay. I'm not worried about these. I'll deal with these transitions later. The other thing I want to do with my rail is I want to make sure that my handle is penetrating into the body of the teapot. Unlike the work we did on the spout, it's a lot easier to get the intersection because this is just, it's not flaring out drastically as it goes in. So it's a much easier shape to do this with. So if I'm going to bring the teapot back, you can see the intersection is pretty obvious here. No problem there on the intersection. So we're actually going to solve the intersection between these two. Interesting. And that gives me this curve. And that curve can be used to trim both of these objects so that I end up with a hole in the teapot and I end up with a trim on the handle. So I'm going to use trim. And I'm going to trim this object and this object. I'm also going to zoom into the mount. I'm going to trim this and this. Sometimes when you're on seam lines, you'll have to use the trim more than once. Okay. So do it. By the way, I just want to get rid of this. Don't really want that. Okay. So that's done that. Now, what I want to be able to do is to fill it or produce a kind of a blend between these two. But in order to do that, I want to first give myself a fighting chance. I'm going to do a little bit of automatic work for me using one of Rhino's tools called fillet. So I want to fillet these two, but before I can do that, I have to join this together. So I'm going to select everything and press join. And when you do that, it should all go the same color to the parent object, which is the body. So it's all joined together, which is great. And now, because it's all joined together, there's an edge in the surface there. Previously, there was an end of a surface and an end of another surface, and you wouldn't be able to fill it those between them. But we can fillet an edge here without a problem. So I'm going to use fillet and type in fillet. And as soon as you do that, come to a fillet edge. That's the one I want. So we're going to go, let's say, well, it's set to a radius of 3, so we'll go with that. There's 3 there, and here, and we'll try filling up 3. Now, I haven't done anything fancy with the commands there, I've just set raise 3. I'm going to look in here, though, and you can see, actually, that's probably not enough. Probably need a slightly bigger radius. Also, you can see the shape here, because we're using a technique called rolling ball. Like it's rolling a ball around the outside and leaving a trace of where the ball was. It's going in and out a little bit. We might be better with a different command, which is distance between rails. So I'm going to do that again. So select, but this time instead of radius, I'm going to choose a radius of 4. Try that. And this is the edge I want to fill it. And that one. Oops, that one. That's cool. And here. And here. Okay. And here on the next command, giving me some options here. Rail type because distance between rails. If you change that, distance from edge, rolling ball. I think I'm going to choose distance between rails. I think that's what it was. There. And that's better. I'm happy with that. It's closer to the edges that I'm looking for. Okay. Except that's not bad. We could probably leave it there. Let's have a look at this under environment map. Or actually, we'll use zebra. Analyze, surface, we use zebra. Now, when you look at this form under zebra analysis, you'll see that the lines of the zebra change drastically their direction. And when they do that, that tells you that the curvature between this surface here, the body of the teapot, and the blend and the fillet that we've made is only tangentially continuing. It means it only comes off at a tangent to the surface. So it actually is fairly abrupt in its directional change. And you will notice this when you look at this object, when it's 3D printed or when it's CNC cut. You'll see those little lines. If we do the analysis under environment map, you'll see a slightly sharp edge there, and that will be apparent. So, if we want to not have that, we need to blend the surfaces together. So, what I'm going to do is to delete and explode this first. is all joined together, so I have to explode everything. And now I can delete this surface. And I can delete this surface. And this one. And this one. But you see, there's an oval, nice oval shape there, but this shape here is a little bit messy. And I think I prefer to have that going straight and then blend these things together. So you get a better version. So what I'm going to do is to extract one of these isochurves at a particular point that I want, out here probably, and then use that to trim this object off. So I'm going to do curve from objects, extract isochurve. And select the surface, that's the surface I want, and the isocurve that I'm looking for is about there. And I can also do the top one at the same time. Oops, didn't want that one. Do it again. There we go. About there. Look good. So we've now got these two isocurves, and I can use those. Trim with. So I'm going to trim now, cutting away only through the apparent intersection here because they are fully intersecting. And that's cutting away those edges there. It's a good move to do that because it can clean up geometry slightly as well. So what we're going to do now is to create the blend between those two surfaces. So it's just as we did before for the spout. We're going to go to Surface Tools, Blend Surface. Select the first segment edge, that's this one. Second segment edge is this one, and this one. And we need to make sure that those curve lines are lining up nicely. So we'll check that on over here. So you can see that's going right the way in. We actually need to push that right back like this. So we probably do, in this case, with offsetting this curve on the surface. So we're going to do offset curve on surface, which is from curve tools. Offset curve on surface. Select curve. Stick. This is the curve. Now, here's a little fix. The curve, the surface edge here, there's no curve on the edge here. There's a surface edge, but there's actually two segments of an edge. So we actually need to make a surface edge. So we're going to do curve. Curve from objects. Duplicate edge. We want that edge and that edge. I'm going to press enter. Right click. And now I'm going to join those together to create one round, one curve. And then I will offset that on this base surface by distance of one or so. Just to make it a little bit further around. Let me do it again, do it two this time. Two. Yeah, I prefer two. Two's a little bit better. And I'm going to use that curve there. Join it together. Trim it. Now I'm going to try blending those two. We'll see what we get. So I'll do surface tools, blend. This edge, this edge, this edge. Check my seam line. Looking good. I'm going to make sure in this view, yeah, that's looking better. I think following the line more accurately now. And we've got a nice blender that looks much closer to the original form than we had at first. So we're good with that. Do the second one. Again, I'm going to check this one. So the right click, repeat the command. This surface, this edge here. Seam line is joining up. And let's have a look at this one. So again, this one could do with green offset as well. So this edge here doesn't have an edge to it, so we're going to do curve. Curve from objects, duplicate edge, and that one, and so join those together. And I'm going to offset those colored skills, curve tools, that's the curve on surface. This is my base surface here. I'm going to do two again for this one. I'm going to take these curves here, join them up again, trim with them, remove the excess material so I have a hole that's the right size. And now, I'll turn the curves off. Except for that one then. Change that object to the body layer. Change object layer. There we go. That's better. Now we can turn those curves off so we don't need to see them. And we'll blend between these two surfaces here. So surface tools. Blend surface. That's my surface edge. Second surface edge. Check that the seam lines up. Enter. And then I have to adjust the end voltages to drop them down a little bit so that they better match the form. Probably take that back a little bit, but it will do. That's good. And now I can bring back in the spec. We should have a fairly nice and fairly close representation so far. So the next stage we're going to get onto is the lid, and we'll see that in a second. Okay, so the last part we're going to do is the lid, and then we'll be done. Right, so it's exactly the same as the hand, as the body basically, but there's a few little tricks here that we need to use. In order to smooth up the workflow slightly. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to create a vertical center line. Quite often you do a vertical center line first. Probably should have done it first. I didn't. So I'm going to make a vertical center line. I'll start with a bit here. And we do this by I'm going to start the line on zero, enter, and then I'm just going to hold my shift key down and click in front view or right view, doesn't matter. To make sure I've got a vertical position. So I have a line that's vertical. So there's my line here, and I can use that to kind of get geometry from in order to build my lid centrally around that point. So I'm going to use the control point curve, and I'm going to get right in close, so I'm going to maximize so we can properly see it. And we want to be able to see a near snap, right? We don't want to have any other int or anything like that, and that will pull the line off. I'll show you. If I go down to int here, you'll see actually that int's okay actually. That int isn't though. See, that's pulled it off to the side. You can see it's sort of over here. So we want it to be a near, and we want it to be around about there. And we're going to have this kind of a solid thing. And I'm just going to follow this line, basically. This is all inside the object, so you don't really be doing this if you're actually going to be fabricating the object. If you're just doing a render of the object, then you probably wouldn't need to do this and go this far. At this point, though, I'm going to hold my shift key down, and I'm going to create three horizontal points. One, there's one already there. There's two, there's three, and then I'm going to finish off with my shift key down on the int. Press enter. What I've done there is make sure the top of this piece is completely flat. I don't want any peak or trough or divot or dimple in the end. I want that to be completely flat. So I've now got a nice profile curve. And that profile curve starts on the line on this vertical axis and ends on this vertical axis. So when I sweep this around in a circle, it's going to create a nice, even, flat bottom, flat top, and flat bottom, okay? The bottom isn't even seen, so I'm not really worried about that, but it's more the top. But before I do that, I'll just control point edit this slightly just to make sure it follows the line just a little bit more accurately. Take my near off, so I can throw me off then. And yeah, it's pretty good. It'll do. I'll leave it there. Okay, so we're gonna revolve this now. So I'm gonna use a revolve, which is under here, revolve. We've used it before. There we go. Start our revolve axis. Well, we've got some nice axis points here. We don't need to use our shift. We can just use these. Hit that and press enter. When we do that, get this full circle. We can go all the way back to the beginning. And what we can remember, if you hit full circle, it will do a nice round full circle for you. And just so we can check my environment map here, I'm just going to put the environment map on this object. Analyze. Surface. Environment map. There we go. You can see when you use the environment map, can you see there's no peak in the middle? Okay? If I was to take this line, and I'm just going to put the smallest little peak in here. Take this control point here. This is deliberately doing. I'm going to put my near point on here actually. So I'm going to put the smallest little peak in. Tiny little peak there, okay? Hardly noticeable, but that's an error. And you'll see why. So we're going to revolve this now. A rail revolve. Rail revolve would be that one. And the full circle. There we go. Right, so that doesn't look too bad until we get the environment map on. Turn the environment map off there and then turn it back on again. Analyze. Surface. Environment map. And now you can see a very annoying, peaky little bit of mess in the middle. And all that was a tiny little error. I'm going to undo that. There we go. And there's the one that we had before. As you can see, it's smooth as silk, which is what we want. Okay, so there's our lid. So make the whole thing, put the EV map on the entire object, get rid of it here. And surface environment map, the whole thing. And now, let's have a look at this, the final object. When there's some more work we can do, quite a lot more work we can do. This is hardly finished because this is only the outside surface. However, there's a lot of work gone into this so far. I think the transitions here are looking okay, not too bad. I think the way that the lid goes into the thing like that into the body of the teapot, I think that's okay. Probably moving around a bit, but this is still an object, so I could actually just manipulate that down very slightly by moving it up and down like this. Just to make sure it's tighter. And that's it. Okay, so if you were to make this into a solid that could be 3D printed or manufactured, we would need to think about what we do with this spout here. And we need to offset the surfaces in by a certain amount. And that can get a little bit tricky. And for now, I think we'll just leave it at that. And give yourselves a pat on the back for getting to this point. And I shall see you in the next one. Thank you very much.